and say, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Come on, shout, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Elder Freeman. Genesis chapter 28. Genesis chapter number 28. We're going to look at verses 21, 22. Can the chapter, what verse? 20 through 22. And Jacob vowed, saying, if God will be with me and will keep me in this way that I go, and will give me bread to eat and rent to put on, so that I come again for the peace, then shall the Lord my God, and this on which I have so appeared, because, and of all that I give thee, I will surely give death unto thee. I want to ask Mr. Sharp, Jacob said, will you repeat after me, James? I give this for baby Christians. It's not for the carnally minded. It is for those who want to be opened to the truth. And in order to understand the story, you must consider the culture of the time. Of the time that this story took place. This story includes family feud. It includes fusion. It includes deceptions. It includes theft, rejection, even sexual failure. And it includes competition. That's why I say it's for the mind. Attention. Will you of the pregnancy? You know the story, Esau. She had pregnancy. And you see the story in chapter 25. The pregnancy was difficult. And she prayed to God, why am I in this difficult pregnancy? And the Lord spoke back to her two nations. A pregnant destiny. Nations are in something surprising. And the older serve the younger. Heard of them because the first as the reality before the father becomes basically the father of the family. Some of you have difficult times right now, that's because you are pregnant with your destiny. You're trying to figure out why am I this? You pregnant with destiny, so is this struggle. The wife of Isaac, pregnant with two. And two nations increased to many nations. She was pregnant with twins. I know that this church, Deacon Richardson, had maybe three or four twins in the family. In the Bible, there are three sets of twins. We know about Esau and Jacob in our text. And then the second set of twins came through Judah, one of the sons of Jacob, whose name God changed to Israel, and we're going to get to that. Judah also had twins by his daughter-in-law. He had an affinity for a prostitute, and he was going to meet a prostitute, but he had no idea that his daughter-in-law wanted a child so bad because her husband, the son of Jacob, had died, and she didn't want to remain childless. So she pretended to be a prostitute, knowing that her father in in-law was into going after prostitutes. Her name is Tamar. Most of you know the story of Tamar. She pretended to be a prostitute. She didn't allow any man to touch her until her father-in-law Judah came, and she came pregnant with twins. Some of you know the story. The names of the twins are Perez and Zerah. And what's so interesting, Sister Birdie, is that there was also a fight for predominance between the twins while they were in the womb. Because Zerah stuck his head out before the birth. And the women that were helping with the birth thought Zerah was going to be the firstborn, and they tied something around his wrist. But when Zerah withdrew the head, Perez came forth. So Perez means breaking forth. My prayer for all of you listening to this message, even though somebody thinks that you're not number one, you're going to break forth. I get somebody to say amen. Perez became number one. Guess what? King David came out of Perez. Guess who else came out and saved Christ? And I'm saying this because a God understands. Jesus came from a lineage of people that had issues. You say God doesn't understand my issues. Yes, he does. The writer of Hebrews says, we have not a high priest who cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted. He understands your issues. Touch someone and say, Jesus understands my issues. He understands. Now, the twins. Remember, we have Canaan, Esau, and Jacob. Then we have Perez and Zerah. And then in the New Testament, the third set of twins actually was one of Jesus' disciples. And you have to study to really get it, because they call him Thomas Didymus. The word Didymus is not really a name. I understand as a Nigerian. If a Nigerian walks in here right now and say to me, my name is Taiwo, I know right away that he has a twin. If somebody else walks in and says, my name is Kende, I know definitely that he has a twin. So when the Bible says Thomas Didymus, we know by the study that that was not a name per se, it's a name indicating that Thomas had a twin. Are you all with me? Now, the story goes on when these two guys grew up. So hear this. The father, Isaac, loved Esau and loves Jacob. But the competition is on. But the competition is on now. So now the father, Isaac, grew old. His eyes were dim. He couldn't see. And the wife heard the father, Isaac, saying to the son he loved, the firstborn. Number one, that's a remedy for disaster. The father loves one and the mother loves the other. I have seen it happen several times. So the mother heard the father saying to Esau, the firstborn, go and cook me some deer. You are a hunter. Go kill some deer and bring the deer to me so that I can bless you with the blessings of the firstborn. The mother heard it. Now through the grapevine, she heard the fire pass behind the door. And the mother said, well, the one I really love is Jacob. So she ran. Listen, I tell you, you don't need to watch soap opera. Just read the Bible. Look at somebody and say, you don't need to watch soap opera. Just read the Bible. You can find yourself in it. So the mother called the son that she loves. I said, listen, this is what I heard. Go and get some meat. I'm going to cook it. And you're going to disguise as your brother. And Jacob said, you know my brother has hair all over him. So don't worry about that. We'll take care of him. Put some hair on Jacob, who really didn't have hair. Talk to me, somebody. You know some people, you grew up, you got hair all over you. You know, I have a sister that had hair and she had to shave. She hated it. But these were two guys. So the mom cooked and pretended that Jacob was Esau. And the father was thinking, this really happened real quick. I just told you, and the food is ready within 30 minutes. Well, this suggests that they cook in oxtail. Because oxtail takes longer. So the father said, how did you do this thing? He told the father some story. So the father asked, and then, your sounds like Jacob. The father wants to bless his son. The father said, remember the mother had already cooked up something, put hair all over the body. Said, you feel like Esau. Again, deception. The name Jacob means flatter. That's why God is named to him. Because Esau means Prince of God. When they were about to be born, when Esau was coming out, was about to pop out, guess who was holding his leg? Jacob. That's why they named him Jacob, meaning supplanter or swindler in our own term. So to make a long story short, the father, being blind, blessed the wrong person, seemingly. You have to understand how God works. God already said to the mother, because of his foreknowledge, that the elder, Esau, will serve, because God had already seen the whole story. God had seen the story of your life before you were born. He already knew everything about you and what you've done and what you're going to do. You cannot surprise God. Look at somebody and say, I can't surprise God. He knows everything about me. He knows about my issues. He knows about my mistakes. He knows about my ups and my downs. That is the kind of God we serve. So listen. The Father in Genesis chapter 27 blessed seemingly the wrong person. I have been into houses when the parents passed away, and you'll be surprised that usually the deceased never leave the estate to the oldest. I didn't understand it because the deceased person knew ahead of time who will be responsible in that family. Talk to me, somebody. I've seen it happen several times. And that's why people have family problems and family fights. I went into one funeral and they didn't even want their pastor to sit in the pulpit with me. I was frustrated, I was a little embarrassed. And there was so much family issues I had to get out of the house. One woman said to me one time, "They're gonna be all surprised when I leave," because she had planned this, everything the way she wanted it to be. She had planned it. She said, "Don't laugh, Pastor." This was an elderly woman. She had lived a good life. She talked to me, she said, "They're all gonna be surprised." And she was smiling when she was talking to me. Now, let's get back to the story. Jacob was blessed instead of Esau. From that time, enmity, hatred came about because now Esau wanted to kill Jacob. We're talking about family feud of the first order. Not the only one in the Bible. They were fighting each other. It will be time. When you look in scriptures, in Bible, Jesus says one of the enemies, one of your enemies from your own household. Talk to me, son. The worst thing that can happen if the people you live, they don't like you and they plot it. Listen, I come from a polygamous family. What issue? I know what family feud. Family on television is not big. Talk to somebody. I mean, family feud is the family. You have to grow up in the Adebanjo family. And some of you are you are laughing because you have your own family feud in your heart. Now you're the one who say amen to that. I know I'm right. Look at him and say, I know he's right. So hatred. So one of the prayers of Jacob is that God protect me from my brother. Look in Genesis chapter 28 verse 20 and Genesis 32 verse 11. He needed protection from his own brother. People that have taken the order of protection, not only from their brothers, sisters, from their fathers, and so on and so forth. At that time, there was no order of protection in the court. You better know God back then. Let's look at his prayer. In Genesis 28 and 20, Jacob vowed a vow. He made a vow, "God, if you will be with me and protect me, keep me in this way that I go." He was praying for protection. Look in Genesis chapter 33, verse 4. What book in the Bible? What chapter? What verse? Genesis chapter 33, verse 4. And this is what it says. If I can get my Bible to cooperate with me. Because in Genesis chapter 33, Jacob was plotting the strategy how to meet his brother again, because his brother was a king. So he put certain people in the front that if he start killing this one, then the rest of us can run. Let's start from verse 1. And Jacob lifted up his eyes and looked, And behold, Esau came with him, his brother. Esau now had 400 men with him. And he divided the children unto Leah. Well, I'll tell you the issues, because when Jacob grew up, he got swindled too. The swindler got swindled by his own uncle, who also happens to be his father-in-law to two women. We're going to talk about that in a minute. But now both of them are meeting. Verse 2, and he put the handmaids and their children forward. You all see what this rascal is doing? He put the maids and their children up front, so that when his brother begins to kill, the rest of them can make a run for the border. And Leah and her children after. Now, Leah happens to be the old girl. Now, let me just go back and tell you about Leah and Rachel. When he got to where he was supposed to get married, he was in love with Rachel. Some of you know the story. The father said, according to our culture, the younger woman cannot get married before the older one. So this is what they're going to do. Remember now, Jacob was in love with Rachel. So his father-in-law left and said, you can't do that because of our culture. You have to marry the older one first. And the older one's the same Greek name is Leah. The Bible says she couldn't even use eyeglasses, because if she's looking this way, her eyes are this way. That's what the Bible said. I didn't say that. So the father said, you want to marry Rachel, you're going to work for me for 7 years. And after 7 years, you can have the one you wanted. Guess what? He worked for 7 years. For Laban, his father-in-law, who also happens to be his uncle, in that time, you marry within the family. You keep it within the family. That was part of the culture. And after 7 years, remember now, the swindler is not being swindled. What goes? After 7 years, the father-in-law said, man, you gotta work 7 more years. Don't marry Rachel. You gotta work 7 more years. In this story, there's also sexual favor because of food. Yeah, I heard somebody say, well. Because there is a time when one of the ladies needed some love apple. Love apple. The Bible calls it mandrake. Love apple. Somebody say love apple. This is no love books now. It's love apple, mandrake. And the one lady said, well, you can go to the husband tonight in exchange for the love apple. It's a true story. I want to see why Jacob was praying, not only for protection, he also prayed for provision, he also prayed for deliverance, because God met him and changed his life. And we come into that in a minute. I got about 5 more African minutes. Look at somebody else. Bishop has about 5 more African minutes.
All right, Bishop.
I love the story. You have to come from the background. You see, God puts me here to teach you about the cultural perspective of the Bible. I heard a preacher years ago, and I said to my wife, who said on television, don't bother to read the Old Testament. Why not? That's part of the Bible. You learn about the culture. The reason some people do not understand foreigners is because foreigners have their own culture, not just the accent. Now, everybody's quiet now. I'm just talking for myself. So now, Jacob put Leah. You don't know why he put Leah next to the maids? Because he never wanted to marry Leah. He wanted to marry Rachel. So the next person he put forward was Leah and her children. And he prayed. I pray you for me, help my brother. Some of you have relatives you got to deliver you from. And you have to say amen. I know that. Delay, I pray you help of my brother out his name from Anto. They have no court order protection back then. For I fear him, let him come and kill me and the mother with the children. Verse 12 of Genesis chapter 32 says, I went to God because he said, God, you said you don't keep me. Verse 32, I will surely do thee good and make thy seed as the sand of the sea, which cannot be numbered for multitude. So he was saying to God, remember the plea? But I'm going to meet Esau who can end everything. Listen, beloved, you know how to pray. Look at someone and say, you've got to know how to pray. You got to know how to pray. You got to be able to talk to God. Some of you haven't talked to him in a long time. You're too much concerned with yourself about how you're going to make it without God, because that was the way Jacob was born. Jacob had opened up a portal. Him and his son. Because there was a time before the father blessed Jacob, Esau asked Jacob again for something of an appetite. And Jacob said to Esau, sell me your birthright. Let me just tell you about your birthright as a child of God. Because you have been born again, you are an overcomer. Because you have given your life to Jesus Christ. Because of your birthright in Jesus, greater is that than he who is in the world. Because of your birthright, through the waters, God will be with you. Believers, let overshadow thee. You can sell your birthright. When you're giving to the enemy, to the appetite, because Esau despised his birthright. Jacob, remember Jacob means swindler, heel grabber. And Jacob said, if you want what I was good, this was way before the father blessed Jacob. I want you to understand the sequence of things. Jacob said, I'll give you this if you sell me your birthright. Esau did not appreciate what he has. And if you don't appreciate what you have, somebody can take it from you. Let me say that again. Esau and Jacob, they opened up portals. I was praying for some people this week because I believe some portals were open. Portals can be opened negatively or positively based on what you do or say. And I was saying to my wife, I said, I am praying because some things that you do out of rebellion or inadvertently can open up some portals. Even though Jacob was born as Esau, despised his birthright. I know who I am as Adebanjo. Nobody can change me. I know my birthright. I know that. You need to know your birthright. Even if your birthright naturally was not good, you can claim your birthright as a child of God. Because you have been born again. Look, somebody says, I've been born again. You got to know your birthright. You got to know your birthright in the Lord. When I was in Germany back in 1971, and some people, of course, some of the similar questions were asked me when I came here, when I was speaking to some students in Franklin. And the Germans was asking me, because at that time, the movie of Tarzan was all over the place. So they just thought, all of us in Africa, we didn't have clothes on. And we played with tigers and lions and monkeys. And they were asking me about the lions and the tigers. And I told them, the lions and the tigers, I saw them in the zoo. In Nigeria. Now my father had some of the most expensive cars. We had telephones. And they were just mesmerized. Therefore, I wasn't telling the truth. And then I came to America. I came to speak to some children. And when I finished, and I opened up for questions, and they were asking them the same question. So you gotta know who you are. You gotta know your birthright as a child of God. Walk like a child of God. Talk like a child of God. Because the greater one lives inside of you. You are King's King. You are royal priesthood. You are a holy nation. Somebody shout hallelujah. My father has been dead for over 30 years. I'm still collecting from the estate. So I know who I am. And I'm not saying that to brag, but I'm trying to say to you, you need to know who you are as a child of God. Esau did not appreciate his birthright. So he sold it to his brother. Look in Genesis chapter 25. When he sold it, and Jacob, you're going to run into some sweetness that will offer you something. They're going to offer you something that is nothing compared to what you have, who you are. I get disturbed by some of the most sanctified, beautiful women in the church, and they go and settle for some gigolo, no good gigolo out there.
Amen.
And I said, what in the world is happening? And I'm just trying to help you. You sell your birthright, you exchange something wonderful for nothing. Then you go through the headache and blah, 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 blah. Well, I'm going to leave it alone. Genesis 32, deliver me, I pray you, from the hand of my brother. But let me show you where he had an encounter with God. Genesis chapter 28, and I'm getting ready to close. I got about three more African minutes. Genesis 28, he got to a place. You got to get to a point in your life.
Yeah.
And he stayed there all night. All night, because the sun was set, and he took the stones of that place. He made a pillow out of a stone. You got to understand what the stone represents. The stone represents Christ. I don't have time to get into that. And while he slept, the Bible says he had a dream. Verse 12 of chapter 28. And behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it. the heavens and behold the angels of God ascending and descending. Ascending and descending. He had an encounter with God. He had an encounter. But let me go back a little bit. When the father blessed Jacob, Esau showed up and said, "Daddy, I brought you the food you asked for." His father was shaking. And please listen to this. His father was troubled and said, "Who are you? I thought Esau had been here." He said, "No, Daddy, I am Esau, your firstborn son." The father was so troubled, he said, "I have blessed your brother, and he shall be blessed." The power of spoken word. I have blessed. It's like, it's just words. No, it's not just words. By thy words, thou shalt be justified. Be positively into the atmosphere. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. The father said, "I have blessed your brother. And yeah, Genesis 27 verse 23, the Bible says Isaac trembled violently. David understood the power of the word. He says, "I shall not die but live to declare the words of the Lord." So he prayed. He prayed to God. He had an encounter, the final encounter was when he said, "God bless me." Chapter 32 verse 26, "Bless me," and God did something to him. God changed his walk, God changed his walk. He had to bend from that day on. Because now he had to lean on God. He had to lean on God. Chapter 32, verse 26. And held on to God. God said, "Oh." He had this. He wrestled with a man later on that was wrestling with his God. You really want to hold on to God regardless of what you're feeling, and I'm ready to close. There are times when things are very tough. See your way. You hold on to like Jacob, I let you go until you bless me. He asked him, the Bible says he wrestled with God, and what God did was he touched his heel. He changed the way he walked for the rest of his life, and then he touched his heart. And then God changed his name from Jacob. So he had the name of God, God didn't tell him. And then God said, "What is your name?" He said, "My name is Jacob." He acknowledged who he was. He said, "I'm Jacob. I am the swindler. I am the supplanter. I am all that you've asked." And God said, "Now, I'm going to change your name to Israel, the Prince of God." When we talk about Israel now, think about Jacob. That was his name before God changed it to Israel. The 12 tribes of Israel. Jacob gave birth to them. "Lord, I cannot let you go until you bless me." The name of the place, Peniel, he said, "The face of God." That's what Peniel means. Everybody standing. The prayers of Jacob. I can say a few more things. But I'm not going to. He prayed. And God said, I cannot let you go. He said to God, "I cannot let you go." Some of you, you don't stay long enough for God to bless you. Sometimes you're mad at the whole world, you're mad at yourself. And so you're staying with God because He's the only one that can help you. I encourage you to read the story. Not only about Isaac, Esau, Jacob. Read about the children. Because Leah was in sorrow, the first rejected wife. And all the children that he had, she gave them names according to how she felt, her sorrows. She gave birth to one and said, "Now will God, will my husband look at me, and I can go on and on." Whatever issues you have, let me end with this. God knows about it. He knows you before your mom and your dad got together. He knows everything about you. Touch someone and say, "He knows everything about you."
Everything about you. Yes, God. Yes.
Everything about you, He does. There's nothing you can do to surprise Him. There's nothing you can do to disappoint God because He had already seen the movies. When God gives a prophecy, it's because He already seen it happen. When He said to the mother, "The elder is going to serve the younger," because He had seen the movies of their lives. He had seen it. When He said, "I will go make you a great nation," when He said that to Jacob, He knew that Jacob wasn't going to die by the hands of Esau. Some of the things you are afraid of is not going to be your end. Look at somebody and say, "Some of the things you are afraid of cannot cancel your destiny." God already seen everything about you. I want to pray for somebody today. Your fears, your issues, He knows everything about whatever you're going through. Your struggles, He knows everything. That's why I can open up to God. I can. The Bible says we are naked before Him. There's nothing to hide. You just talk to Him. That's what He wants. I want to pray for you. If you're here, and I know you are, and you want God to touch you again, I want you to come. I want you to come quickly, quickly.
Glory. Oh, bless me now.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. I don't know the song of Jabez in Elijah territory. You know that song?
Bless me. Bless me. Oh Lord, bless me indeed, enlarge my territory. Oh,
lift up your hands and receive it.
Bless me indeed.
Bless you. Say it again. It's time for the ministry of giving.